And thank you everybody for being with us on this really sunny afternoon. It's wonderful that so many of you are here despite the weather. We were saying if it rains, people might not come. If it's too sunny, people might not come. So we're really pleased that you can be here with us and all of the incredible women that we've gathered today. I'm just going to briefly introduce Alda Facio, who's going to be the moderator for the event. Alda Facio is the co-founder of the Women's Human Rights Education Institute. We're actually at the end of a week of studying about the Women's Convention, the UN Women's Convention, CEDAW. So there's a number of local and international women that are seated over here that have been together for the week learning. And so we wanted to bring this session and open it up so that anybody who wanted to come and learn and understand how these international mechanisms are being claimed and used by Indigenous communities both in Canada and in Mesoamerica. So we welcome everybody who joined the class, and we're also very happy to have an incredible group of women's human rights defenders with us. Alda Facio is from Costa Rica, and she's a feminist jurist and human rights activist with decades of work promoting feminist and transformative interpretations of the UN Women's Convention. Alda has a very illustrious bio, and you have lengthier bios in your program, so I won't say too much other than to say that Alda has dedicated her life as a tireless feminist activist to opening spaces so that more and more women can come and claim their rights and utilize that framework as a way to support the work that they do. Woo! So it's my great pleasure, as always, to work with Alda, and I'll turn the mic over to her.
Thank you, Angela. Good afternoon. I'm very excited to be ending our week-long class on studying CEDAW with this panel of incredible Indigenous women who will share with you two ways in which Indigenous women from different parts of the world, Canada and then Guatemala, and hopefully the whole world, will be using CEDAW to better the lives of Indigenous women and women from other parts and other ethnicities and all this. But I want to also acknowledge that here we have an incredible group of women, and some women from so far away as Mongolia. So welcome here, and I hope you will be able to ask questions and be part of this panel. The first speaker is over there, Cherry Smiley, who will briefly speak of the solidarity campaign and the missing and murdered Indigenous women issue in a more general way. And she's coming representing Fafia. And you have her a longer bio in your little page that you were given, so I won't introduce them. Also, they'll give them more time to talk about what the issue. And the second speaker is next to me, he's to my left, which is Dawn Lavelle Harvard from NWAC, and she will be speaking about this CEDAW inquiry that was done 2 years ago, I think it was, but the report came out just last year. On the murdered and missing Indigenous women of Canada. And the third speaker is not present, but she will be seen in the, what do you call that? The field. No, the screen. I forgot the screen. The screen from on Skype, the Sheila Day from the West Coast, who will talk about how they're going to be plans on how they're to use this report on the murdered and missing Indigenous women of Canada. And then the fourth speaker will be Silvia Tecun Leon, who will be translated by Lorena, right? You're going to be translating Lorena Gajardo. And she will talk about an initiative that began in her organization, Sununija of Guatemala, to petition the CEDAW committee for a general recommendation on the right, individual and collective rights of Indigenous women. And they are asking for the support of all women to petition the CEDAW so that this general recommendation will come into effect. So before handing the microphone over to Cherry, I just want to very briefly explain that the CEDAW Convention, which is the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, did not have a communications or inquiry procedure until 2000, until the year 2000, when the optional protocol was adopted. And this optional protocol mandates the CEDAW committee to be able to receive communications from women who think they have been victims of human rights violations, or to petition the committee to do inquiries on serious or grave violations of women's human rights. And so the Indigenous Women of Canada petitioned through FAFIA and NWEC, petitioned the committee to make this inquiry, and with a lot of resistance from the Canadian government, but finally the committee realized this inquiry, and this is what you will hear a bit about today. And hopefully you will learn and use this inquiry to promote the end of violence against Indigenous women in Canada. So I give you Cherry Smiley.
All right, so the first thing that I would like to do is to recognize that we are on Anishinaabe territories, and to thank the Anishinaabe people for allowing, to thank them and to recognize them as the traditional inhabitants and caretakers of these lands that we're standing on. My name is Cherry Smiley. I come from the Tiklatmuc or Thompson Nation, from the Nicola Valley in the interior of British Columbia, and also from the Diné or Navajo Nation from the southwestern United States, kind of near New Mexico. And I'm here today as a representative for FAFIA, the Feminist Alliance for International Action, and I coordinated FAFIA's campaign of solidarity with Aboriginal women, which is a campaign that was really looking to bring attention to both the CEDAW report, as well as another report that was released earlier this year from the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. So to bring attention to these two reports around their release, which was just recently, but also really to try and make sure that these reports don't just sit on the shelf. So really trying to make sure that we help women understand what's in these reports, and understand how we can use these reports as a mechanism to advance the rights of Indigenous women and girls here in Canada. So I come to this work as an Indigenous woman. I think sometimes we get a lot of statistics, and we hear Dawn's going to talk a bit more about the rates of violence, poverty, criminalization, all of these things that Aboriginal women are facing here in Canada today in 2015. But when I read those statistics, I see the faces of my family members and my community members, women that I know and that I love. So I come to this work from that place of love. And I also come to this work as a frontline anti-violence worker. So I worked for a number of years in a rape crisis center and transition house out on the West Coast, so working with women who'd been sexually assaulted, raped, experiencing all forms of male violence. So I'm going to start, we're going to bring it back a little bit. I want to talk a little bit about my grandma and my grandma's stories. And I'm very fortunate. I was raised in large part by my maternal grandmother, who's 93, by the way, and still kicking, and she's an amazing woman. But I was really fortunate in that I was able to grow up with these stories. My grandma, we would wake up in the morning, and she still has a wood-burning fireplace, and I loved those moments in the morning, in the winter, when it was really quiet, and it was only her and I awake. And sometimes we'd sit there and she'd tell stories, and sometimes we would just sit there in silence. But my grandmother painted this picture for me. My grandmother, aunties, different Indigenous women that I've met across Canada have painted this picture for me of our women as strong, as beautiful, as respected, valued, loved. Women in our communities were seen and treated as equals. We had decision-making roles in our communities. So this is all kind of a pre-contact blood memory or memories that I carry around with me that aren't necessarily my memories, but that are memories of the women that have come before me, of what things looked like before we got ourselves, or the situation that happened before we are in the situation that we are in now. So, it wasn't perfect. I think sometimes there's a tendency to romanticize what this was. So it wasn't perfect. But I do know from these stories that the systemic issues that we're dealing with today did not exist pre-contact. And I sometimes, the work that we do is very hard, and it really weighs heavy on your heart sometimes and on your spirit sometimes. And, there's times where I feel like I move away from that memory, and it's very painful, and it gets very scary. I ground myself, I come back, I talk to women that I know, that I love, and I that memory gets a little more clear in my mind. So I have empathy, and I can't imagine what that's like for people that don't get to carry those stories. So I know all of us here, we're trying to share that story with all of you. So that when you feel anxious, when you feel scared, when you feel frightened, you'll have this memory to come back a little closer to, and feel renewed and hopeful. So I'm gonna read a definition of colonialism, and I know that we're all very I'm certain that we're all very read on the issue, but sometimes it helps to come back to the basics. So this definition of colonialism that I have is from an article titled Prostitution of Indigenous Women, Sex Inequality, and the Colonization of Canada's First Nations Women. So the definition that was in this article defines colonialism as a process that includes geographic incursion, sociocultural dislocation, the establishment of external political control and economic dispossession, the provision of low-level social services, and ultimately the creation of ideological formulations around race and skin color, which position the colonizers at a higher evolutionary level than the colonized. So, I think we're all familiar, somewhat with that definition, but I'm going to talk a little bit about how we got from this memory that I painted for you to where we are today, where we are now. So this history of colonialism includes policies and practices that not only devalued Aboriginal peoples as a whole, but particularly devalued Aboriginal women and girls. And this is partially because our women and girls are considered the hearts of our nations. So we're kind of the backbones of our communities. So one of these ideas and beliefs that was imposed onto our communities is patriarchy. And I think sometimes we don't talk enough about that and how this is kind of the backdrop to the situation of the murders and disappearances of Aboriginal women and girls and at the root. So this imposition of patriarchy has been one that's very painful, and I think it's one that it's so everywhere. It's so everywhere that it's like it's nowhere. So it's in our pop culture, our music. We're seeing the hypersexualization of young girls, Indigenous and non-Indigenous. So we're kind of working in this battlefield where men are feeling entitled to sex, where men are violating women and girls almost with impunity. We live in a culture where rape jokes, and I say that in quotation marks, are mainstream. We see it, movies, you hear it on the radio. It's become such a part of our culture, and such an obvious part of our culture. So some other examples, so some of the ways in which patriarchy and also capitalism, this very neoliberal idea, everybody, you know, pull up your bootstraps, and every man for himself, literally. And where greed is kind of the dominant ideology, it was also imposed. So I think it's very important that when we talk about colonialism, we're always talking about capitalism, we're talking about patriarchy, and we're talking about these very racist ideas that non-Aboriginal people have about Aboriginal people and Aboriginal women in particular. So one of the ways in which these ideas were imposed onto our communities was through the Indian residential school system. And I think we all have, I know that there's been in the past little while, definitely some more discussion about this tragedy. And I think we're stepping in the right direction, but then we have a lot to learn more about that process. So we're kind of just beginning to uncover what happened with the Indian residential school system. So oftentimes I hear people say, well, or I'll read, well, people will say it, but I'll also read it on the internet a lot, and people will say, well, why don't you just get over it? This happened, you know, so long ago. Just get over it. So the last residential school in Canada closed in 1996. So this is in all of our lifetimes. This is not something that happened hundreds of years ago. And even if it were, we're still dealing with the consequences, because that system, the residential school system, was so well thought out in terms of how it was going to interfere with the transmission of culture. And in particular, the transmission of culture from grandmother to mother to daughter. So the residential schools had devastating effects. And, you know, like I said, we're beginning to uncover that. And I think we've seen some of that in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and what happened there. So two things that I'd like to point out about the impacts of the residential schools. So one is that interference of transmission from grandmother to mother to daughter. So these schools taught Aboriginal children that they had no value. They taught them that they weren't allowed to speak their languages. Their languages were wrong. Their culture was wrong. The way they spoke was wrong. The way they thought was wrong. So everything about them was wrong. And these systemic lessons from the schools continue to have impacts on Aboriginal peoples today. And you see that in the difficulties that many Aboriginal people are still facing in terms of lack of parenting skills, again, because the schools interfered purposefully with that transmission. Suffering from the physical and sexual abuse that happened in those schools, from those traumas. The second thing that I think we don't often talk about with the residential schools is the impact that the residential schools had on non-Aboriginal people. And, I don't mean to say that non-Aboriginal people were harmed in the same way, because they weren't. But the schools did educate, as well, non-Aboriginal people about Aboriginal people. So they taught non-Aboriginal people that Aboriginal people had no value, that we were savage, that we were backwards, that everything about us was wrong. So I think we don't often talk enough or reflect enough about the impacts of those schools and the education that non-Aboriginal people also received from the residential school system. So, I think it's also really important to note that at the residential schools, mortality rates were very, very high. So you were essentially lucky to survive the residential school system. Many children were not able to survive that system. Many of the schools had graveyards that were actually attached to the schools, so that they could bury the children in those schools. And I think, in my opinion, anyways, these schools really set up children for quick deaths in the school, or slow deaths over a lifetime of dealing with this trauma, right? A lifetime of dealing with a loss of culture, a loss of language, a loss of self. And when you have that loss, our people are being then offered drugs and alcohol as a coping mechanism, and are suffering with so much trauma that, oftentimes it's a very slow decline, to a very proud, strong people. But that's not to say it's hopeless, because it's certainly not. and we are organizing, you know, we are fighting back against this. But, you know, it's a national crisis. It's a tragedy. So we need to keep in the front of our minds that these processes of colonialism are ongoing. So the consequences of the residential schools are ongoing. And then it's reinforced by popular culture, music, TV, you know, internet, all of these things, these types of media that are educating the public that girls and women have no value, that Aboriginal women and girls especially have no value and can be considered disposable. So, the residential schools, you know, my father was a boarding school survivor of the American school system. And so I speak from a place that, you know, that experiencing that trauma as well, that loss of self, of identity. You know, of those things. I think a second colonial practice that has really helped to impose patriarchy, you know, capitalism, racism, so this devaluing of women was the Indian Act as well. And the Indian Act, again, people say, oh, get over it. You know, colonialism, that happened a long time ago, I have nothing to do with it today. But the Indian Act is a piece of legislation that is still in practice today, and it governs the lives of status First Nations people. So what the Indian Act did was it created categories of Indians, in quotation marks, so non-status and status, and afforded certain rights to status First Nations people and denying these rights to non-status First Nations people. The other thing that the Indian Act did was up until the 1980s, it removed status from First Nations women who married non-Aboriginal men. So again, we see the same attempt by the state to interfere with the transmission of culture from grandmother to mother to daughter. So attacking the hearts of our nations, right? The backbones of our communities. Oftentimes then, First Nations women who had lost their status were forced to leave their communities. That was partially rectified in the 1980s and again just recently. So now we have a number of First Nations people that are entitled to status, being able to reclaim that status. But the damage that was done, again, from that transmission of culture from grandmother to mother to daughter, we're still dealing with the consequences of that. So we find ourselves in a situation where, and if you remember earlier, where our women were strong, our women were decision makers in our communities, our women were, you know, respected and valued, you know, and we find ourselves in a situation where our women are still strong and, you know, loved and, you know, intelligent and making decisions in our families and in our communities. We find ourselves in a situation where our women are being devalued and being murdered and disappeared at rates where we should be. This should be the number one issue on the forefront of everybody's minds. You know, it's astounding to me when I think about it. It makes me feel like. It's like I can't believe it. I think every person in Canada should be thinking that. Oh my, like I can't believe it. I can't believe this is happening. You know, and I hope in 100 years we're going to be looking back, and we're going to be saying, how did we ever do this to each other? You know, I hope that we get to a place where we can look back. I think Dawn's going to talk a lot more about the situation that we find ourselves in today, in terms of the rates of violence, the murders and disappearances of Aboriginal women and girls. You know, it's been a long road to where we are today, and unfortunately we're not going to turn this ship around, I think, as quickly as we would like to, because we have a lot of undoing, and we have to re-educate ourselves, and we have a lot of undoing of this really misinformation that we've been taught about Aboriginal women in particular. The idea of the squaw is one that's very, very prevalent, and it's kind of this savage woman who's, you know, hypersexualized and, you know, dehumanized to a level that that violence can be perpetrated against her with impunity. So, you know, I think that undoing, you know, begins with each one of us. So I think I'm going to let Dawn talk a little bit more about where we are currently, but to just keep in the backs of your minds, both that we're, this issue is one that is specific to Aboriginal women and girls, but also one that is confronting all women and girls in terms of violence against, you know, violence, sexualization, objectification, all of these types of things. So I think if we work towards a better future for Aboriginal women and girls, by default, we're working towards better communities for all of us. So thank you.
Well, thank you, Cherry. That was very moving. And it sort of enraging, can you say that in English? It gives me very angry when I hear those things. And when I was reading about the inquiry procedure and all the ways that the government of Canada was trying to stop this inquiry and really stop it for several years, and finally they were able to come and do this inquiry, and then they stopped it from being publicized so that they didn't want the world to know. And I think it was until February, wasn't it? This year, February, that they were able to publicize it so that the world can know of what was happening still now to Aboriginal women in Canada, which for many people, and I know because we have this international institutes, they're so surprised. They don't think that these things happen in a developed country, right? And so it's very important for the world to know about this, and also because As Cherry said, I think that if the lives of Indigenous women are improved all over the world, by default, the lives of all women will be improved. So thank you, Cherry. Our second speaker is Dr. Dawn Lavelle Harvard from NWAC, and she will talk more specifically about the inquiry and about what's happening to Indigenous women here in Canada. Thank you.
All these things I'm supposed to talk about that I never follow anyways. So I want to thank you very much to our elder for starting us off in a good way. And I want to acknowledge that we are here today on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of New Credit. And as mentioned, I am Dawn Lavelle Harvard from the Native Women's Association of Canada. And all of my feminist friends, you know, as a staunch feminist for a long time, they always ask, you know, why did you add your husband's name? You know, you should have stuck with your maiden name. And I said, no, but, you know, now as an academic, everything I say, people get to say, well, according to recent Harvard research. That's just whatever I thought of this morning, because my name is Harvard. So it gives some credibility to everything I say. But, you know, people often ask how I got here, and I don't mean, you know, down the 401 and almost ram somebody, that's a whole different story. But as Indigenous women, we're well acquainted with gender discrimination. When Cherry was talking about the discrimination, you know, back in the 70s, when my mother, Jeanette Corby Lavelle, married my father, who was non-Aboriginal, she lost her status. She got a check in the mail for $12 and a letter from the Aboriginal Affairs, Department of Indian Affairs at the time, saying that you are no longer an Aboriginal person. You know, here's your check, basically thanks for coming out. She never cashed that check because that was the 70s. That was a time where she was part of a large number of, you know, civil rights groups and a lot of, you know, movement for change. And she recognized and she knew that that was wrong. That as an Indigenous woman, you know, our identity, our lives are worth much more than $12. And it was clear gender discrimination because Aboriginal men who married non-Aboriginal women did not have that same experience. So they went all the way to the Supreme Court here in Canada. And shockingly, at the Supreme Court level, one of the Supreme Court judges actually told her that he didn't understand what all the fuss was about. In order for this to be considered discrimination, you had to show that you had lost something, that you had some sort of hardship or harm because of this act. And he said, we've all seen what it's like on an Indian reserve. You should be happy a white man would have you. Basically, that in his opinion, she had not lost anything of value because she had lost her right to be a status Indian, that her life circumstances had improved. Even though she could no longer be a member in her community, she lost her land, she lost her family. But her family spoke up and said, no, we don't care. Doesn't matter what the government says, you will always be a member of this community. And interestingly, at that time, even the chief in our own community came forward and he says, you know, I really believe in what you're doing, because his own sister was affected by this and a great number of his family members and our community members. But he said, but you understand that as a chief, a government paid chief, I can't support you publicly. I will be speaking out against you when we get to Ottawa. Those chiefs went to Ottawa with expense accounts and fancy plane tickets while our women, and at the time it started at the Ontario Native Women's Association, were baking brownies and having bake sales and checking in one woman in a hotel, and she would go around the back and open up the fire escape and 12 women would sneak in and they would all share that room. Because we knew grassroots activism, we had to get there. That's what we had to do to get there, to fight for our rights in order to be able to make our voices heard. And that's where groups like the Ontario Native Women's Association started. And eventually, as they came in several other provinces, we all joined together into the Native Women's Association of Canada to speak out. And the National Indian Brotherhood at the time, what is now the AFN, which is completely government funded, spoke out against our women, came forward and spoke against our women. And that's why Indigenous women's grassroots organizations are so important, because they are the ones who have the heartbeat of the communities. They know what's going on. And because we don't ever get a heck of a lot of government funding, because we all know you can't bite too hard on the hand that feeds you. So the fact that we're not well supported by government means that we will continue to speak out on the truth and not be held back by those funding criteria. And as Cherie mentioned, you know, unfortunately, as a result of hundreds of years of broken treaties, of patriarchy, of colonization, of racism and sexism, I mean, we all know there is basically a war on women in this world. The discrimination, the abuse, the violence against women. But in this country, there's been a war on Indigenous people for a long time too. So if you are Indigenous and female, guess what? You're at the very bottom of that totem pole, the lowest of the low, the most vulnerable. Although I would argue also that we are actually in the most vulnerable position, because my sisters who are living on the streets and raising their families and ending up with doctors and lawyers for those kids who grew up on the streets, those are not vulnerable women. Those are resilient, strong women who are in vulnerable circumstances. And that's a big difference, because those are the women who are the future of our nations. But this is the reality. You know, we have a crisis here in Canada. When we started doing this work back in the 80s, the Ontario Native Women, we did a little small kitchen group study. We asked all the Indigenous women we knew about their experience of violence. And it came out that, you know, almost 8 out of 10, 75% of those women were victims of violence. And in our fly-in communities, the remote communities, it was as high as 95%. And I know people from other countries don't realize, and most people in Canada have no idea this is going on, and it's because of that remoteness in many of our communities, because of the fact that many of our communities have no roads. There is no way to get in or out of those communities unless you have an airplane. And at $3,000 or $4,000 a ticket, most people can't afford to get in or out. So the circumstances, the fact that many of our communities are living in third world conditions in the middle of one of the richest countries of the world, nobody ever sees it. We send aid through Foster Parents Plan, happily to countries over the ocean, to countries far, far away where we can feel good about it. When children are starving, you know, 60% of the kids in our First Nations are living in poverty right here. And some of them are not even flying communities. They're 5 minutes down the road from where you and I work here in Canada, and we just ignore them because it's been swept under the rug and it's been hidden. This is the reality. We have these levels of violence. When we started Sisters in Spirit, we had 500 names that we had found on the internet of missing Indigenous women, murdered Indigenous women. By the time we were finished, and we were finished because the government closed down the Sisters in Spirit initiative because we were getting too much attention internationally. We were told we could not talk about Sisters in Spirit, we could not use the phrase Sisters in Spirit or the logo or the Grandmother Moon symbol that has been our symbol. But as my father always says, that the fastest way to make sure Anishinaabe woman does something is to tell her she can't. So of course we kept working. If it meant we volunteered, we had to volunteer. And through our volunteering, you know, we were at 680 names when the Sisters in Spirit initiative ended. And through volunteering, we got up to 800. And we know that's just the tip of the iceberg because those are only the ones that make the news. There's so many more that are just tossed aside and nobody cares. They don't even make the news. The RCMP came out and said, you know, you're just a bunch of women. You don't have access to the real data. You know, that's all anecdotal. That's what they like to call it. They said, you know, we have access to the hard data. We're going to set out to prove you. We'll prove you wrong. We have the real data. Okay. And they did. They absolutely proved us wrong. We only had 800. They came back with 1,180. And that was almost a year ago. And we know every week I open my newspaper, I turn on my iPad, and there's another Indigenous woman who's gone missing, whose body has been found wrapped and tossed in the river, cast aside like so much garbage here in Canada. So we know it's up to 1,200 missing and murdered Indigenous women now. But when we went to the UN, everybody talks about, that's not Canada. Canada's beautiful. Canada is like the champion of human rights. Canada is like busy shining the light on the other countries where there's violations of human rights. I mean, it's a great distraction. My brother likes to use that at dinner too, and he's already eaten all of his steak. And he's like, oh, hey, look out with the dog. And you look, and he's busy stealing my dinner. That's what Canada does. Hey, look over there. Look what's happening in Africa. Look what they're doing with genital mutilation. Look what they're doing with child marriages. We have to end child marriage. They're spending millions of dollars. Big, big presentation. And not that it shouldn't be stopped. That's not my point. I absolutely agree it should. But the Canadian government is spending millions and millions of dollars to focus, to shine the light on other countries. Other countries' treatment of women as a way of distracting from the treatment of Indigenous women right here in Canada. I like to follow Harper on Twitter, you know, sort of the same way when you drive down the 401 and there's a big car wreck and you just can't help but look at it. Like, you know you shouldn't, but you know it's going to be really bad, but you just can't not look. And I follow Harper on Twitter every so often, and you know, recently he tweets about how, you know, the world's most vulnerable people, the women and children, are an issue closest, near and dear to his heart. Unless you're an Indigenous woman here in Canada. Because for that, when he was asked about, you know, what he was going to do about the overwhelming rates of missing and murdered Aboriginal women, when these, you know, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights came out, when the UN CEDAW report came out, he said, it's not on his radar. He'll have the people who are concerned about it address it. Which, you know, nice implication there. He's not concerned about it, obviously, because he's not included in those people. How do we have a country where the premier of every province and territory, where 3/4 of the Canadian population, when they were polled, every national Aboriginal organization has spoke out against violence against Aboriginal women and girls? Every group has supported the call for a national inquiry. And unless things went radically wrong last time I went on a maternity leave, this was still a democracy last time I checked. So how can we have, there is no country outside of those provinces and territories. How do we have a national, a federal government that says it's not on their radar? that says they're not going to support it. That's why going to the UN, going to CEDAW was so important. And when we were at the UN, we were with the Canadian delegation, and we asked what they were going to do about violence against Indigenous women. Were they going to talk about it? And they said no, because violence against Indigenous women is not an international concern. All of my sisters from South America, all of my sisters from New Zealand and Australia, from the Sami Nation, agreed. They know this is an international concern. But yet the Canadian government keeps looking the other way, distracting. They bragged. They stood up at the Indigenous Issues Forum, the permanent forum, bragging about the 44 shelters they fund across Canada. They didn't tell anybody from all of those other countries who don't realize that there's 633 First Nations. They're real proud of the 44 shelters. That means there's almost 600 First Nations without a shelter. 600 communities where women have no safe place to go. I had a friend who put her baby on her back in one of those flying communities and walked about 100 miles through the bush to get to safety because she didn't have a shelter in her community. She almost starved, almost didn't make it. But that is a resilient, strong, young Indigenous woman, and that's what our women have to go through here. And this was not 200 years ago, not 50 years ago. This was a year ago. This is Canada. People have no idea. The federal government's proud. They have 135 First Nation communities with boil water advisories, but they're proud because that's down. It was 200 last year. Nobody could imagine that in Canada there's communities with no clean water. It's not conceivable, and yet that's the situation our women are facing. Because the RCMP, everybody often talks about why is this happening? And this is important to understand before we get into the CEDAW report. The at-risk arguments, the RCMP, they like to talk about the fact that, you know, they live high-risk lifestyles. That Indigenous women, the homicide victims, you know, that while homicide rates for women in Canada in general have gone down over the last 30 years, for Indigenous women, they continue to go up. We're almost 30% of the homicides, even though we're less than 5% of the population. The RCMP like to blame the victim. What is it about these women that is causing them to be victims of homicide? Well, they must be drunk. That's their favorite one. They point to the fact that they're twice as likely to have income from crime. If you actually look at the numbers, it's 18% compared to 9%. That's 9%. Pardon me, who gives a rat's ass? This is a university. If you're doing research, 9% is not an important factor. And interestingly, when you look at it, let's do the math backwards. That means 82% were totally legitimate. Just somebody's mom, a secretary, a teacher, the janitor in the school. Nobody points to that, so why are we focusing on the criminal aspect? It's a way of blaming those women. Then they like, this is their favorite one, they're twice as likely to be involved in the sex trade. But it's 12%. Again, that means 88% were just somebody's daughter, somebody's sister, who happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Happened to be Indigenous. Let's be really honest here. Because they're Indigenous, and because they're women, and they're in Canada, that's why they're at risk. And I agree, our people are at risk. Absolutely. Our women are at risk, not because it's a choice. Our little girls don't go running around playing with, you know, prostitute Barbie, or, you know, playing homelessness games with their sleeping bags set up in their bed. No. Nobody dreams of being homeless. Nobody dreams of being in the streets. Our women are born at risk because we're born in communities with third world conditions, communities that have many have no schools. I already said 135 have no clean water. Housing crises in almost all of our communities. They have homes. Our children are apprehended. 75% of the apprehensions are for neglect, and it's neglect because those kids are coming to school with no jackets, no coats, or they're not clean. Well, how do you keep your kids' clothes clean when you have a house with 17 people living in it, no hydro and no water, no sewer? The toilet is a bucket in the corner, and that's in Canada right now. No amount of parenting classes is going to change that, is going to get those kids back. Because honestly, no amount of parenting classes, all it does is our women know even more. They know what they want to provide for their kids, but they can't because of the history we have here. The police response. This is one of our fundamental problems here in Canada. The lack of respect that our women get. If a family goes to the police to report someone missing, very often we get no response. Very often we're told, come back in a few days. We had a case where a family member went to the police and tried to report her sister missing. They said, she's probably just out partying. Come back next week if she hasn't come back. When they finally took her report the following week, they realized that that sister was actually in the prison lockup, in the jail, in the back. She had been arrested for being drunk and disorderly while the sister was standing at the front desk, and they wouldn't even take her name. Then later that same weekend, they picked up that woman after they had released her. They had picked her up in the streets, and they had taken to her emergency because she had been very badly beaten while she was on the street. She escaped, she ran away from the hospital, and has never been seen again. Had those police taken 10 seconds to say, what's your name? They would have realized that they had her sister in the back when she was standing at the front desk, and they wouldn't even take her police report. Wouldn't even ask her name. That's the kind of response that our families get all the time. Families are told, why do I care? That's just one less hooker on my beat. That's one less welfare check my taxes have to pay for. They're probably runaways. They're probably just gone out partying. They'll come back. Maybe they don't want to be found. That's the latest one. And we see the difference. And I'll explain. Shannon Alexander and Maisie Ojig went missing. They were two girls, like 16 and 17, in the Ottawa area. Their parent, they were supposedly sleeping over at the one girl's house. The next morning, they couldn't be found. Their wallets, their backpacks, their cell phones were found at the one girl's house. Now everybody knows if a 16-year-old girl is going to run away, 16-year-old girls don't go anywhere without their cell phone, period. They don't go to the toilet without a cell phone. That's, you can see them texting away. But these girls, everybody said, no, they've probably run away. And so while they're busy arguing over jurisdiction, because it's between the Quebec police, the Ontario police, the Ottawa police, and the RCMP, and they're busy arguing over whose jurisdiction it is, therefore it's nobody's responsibility, at the same time, a young boy went, he was a runaway. They knew that. He had gotten into a fight with his parents over something. They took away his Xbox, so he decided to run away. And I'm not saying that he deserves any less of a response. I mean, people were out there. They had the police, the fire departments, the canine units, the local Boy Scout troops. Like, it was all over the news all night, them walking down the railway tracks through the cornfields looking for this young boy who was a known runaway. And I'm not saying he doesn't deserve that. I mean, they had the Coast Guard. They had everybody out there looking for him. The difference is he deserved that response, absolutely. But so did our girls. And that fact that nobody was looking for those girls in Ottawa, the same age, and the difference was they're Indigenous girls. The family in Ottawa had to hire a private search, private party to go look for those girls before any of the police could be bothered to figure out who was responsible. And this is the kind of thing, these are the stories that when James and I came to Canada after, you know, we had years, this started years ago, you know, 2004, 2008. There's report after report that goes to the UN about the tragedy of missing and murdered Indigenous women here in Canada, about the discrimination. There's been report after report asking Canada that they need to address the issue of violence against Indigenous women and girls. Now, back in 2008, the Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination urged Canada to examine the reason for the failure to investigate all of these many cases of missing and murdered Aboriginal women and take the steps to address the deficiencies in the system, those cracks in the system, those police that don't respond, those families who get turned away by institutions that are supposed to help but turn their backs. You know, in the winter of 2010, Canada submitted their information to the committee, and in the summer of 2010, the committee said, no, that's not good enough. They want further information, and they said that in their opinion, that it was not enough. It had not been implemented. In 2011, the committee again wrote to Canada affirming its serious and ongoing concern. They had submissions from Amnesty International, from FAFIA, from the BC CEDAW group. And in 2011, FAFIA and the Native Women's Association asked CEDAW committee to initiate the inquiry under Article 8 of the optional protocol. And after much stalling and blocking and preventing them from coming to Canada, in 2013, they were eventually granted permission. And we took James and I across the country. We used our provincial organizations. We took him to meet women across the country where he took testimony from our members, from our women, from our families, from those families whose loved ones are still missing. He went across the entire country. And then when he left, he went back and reported that this was indeed a grave violation of the human rights of Indigenous women here in Canada. And not just a violation because of the failure to persecute, to arrest and punish the perpetrators, but they were very clear that it was the failure to protect Indigenous women and girls, the failure to prevent the violence. They acknowledged the fact that 13 is the average age that our women enter into the sex trade. Our women, young girls. I mean, arguments about prostitution, whether it's a choice or not, are irrelevant when 13 is the average age that they start. Because even my crappy math skills tell me that that means that for every girl who was 15 or 16, how many were 10, 11, and 12 to make 13 the average? Cherry was describing that situation that leads to a country where our girls as young as 8 have been approached in the streets by traffickers, in the parks, on their way home from school, by those trying to recruit them into the sex trade. And that's why a while ago, one of our elders, she talked to me and she says, you know, why are you talking about missing and murdered Aboriginal women? And I thought, because they're missing and they're murdered. It made sense to me. She says, no, you don't understand. She says, my wallet goes missing. My keys go missing all the time. She says, my glasses go missing 10, 12 times a day. People don't get misplaced. People are taken. These girls are being taken. They're being stolen from our communities. People don't get misplaced. And that's when I realized that's the truth of what's happening here. These girls are being stolen from our families, from our communities, and very often it's not their fault. They're not always even the ones in the streets. Our best and brightest are being preyed upon. Their hope for a better life, they're being promised help finding a job. You know, you can stay at my house and I'll help you go back to school. There's international freighters coming into the port in Thunder Bay. And girls are invited out for parties and never seen again. Once they leave that port, they're in international waters and they're gone. This is the reality here in Canada. This is what we took James Anaya to see when he was here. This is what our sisters in South America, when we spoke together, they said they had no idea that it's the same as what's happening to our sisters in Mexico, our sisters in Guatemala, our sisters in all of those countries where Indigenous women are treated like so much trash. And we were asked the other day, why is the rate of violence so high? Why does this continue to happen? Because for hundreds of years, nobody gave a shit. It was just another Indian. And it's sad, but that's true. And that's why it's important that we're here today, because here we are in a room where if I took every Indigenous man, woman, and child and put them on buses and we all went to Ottawa, it would still be a whisper that Harper could claim he doesn't hear under that rock he lives under, where it's not on his radar. But if all of us get together, because this is not an Aboriginal issue, this is not a feminist issue. I mean, this is a national tragedy, and this is a national shame, and this needs to be everybody's issue. Everybody here in Canada, everybody in North and South America, and everybody globally needs to shine a light and look at Canada and say that this needs to stop. And that's why we are gonna carry forward with the CEDAW protocol. Sheila's gonna tell us how we're gonna keep it alive so that it's not just brushed under the rug like one more report that's gonna gather dust. And I thank you all for being here today, because you are now all been recruited into keeping that alive. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Don. That was so inspiring. As Don said, we're going to have Sheila now on the screen, hopefully. Keep your these technologies. Is she there? Oh! Can she see the people here or no? Oh, okay. Smile at her.
I can.
Hello, Sheila. Can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Okay.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Can I go ahead?
Yes.
Okay. So I want to welcome you to my kitchen in Vancouver. Through technological brilliance, we're able to do this. And I want to tell you that my kitchen is on the territories of the Musqueam, Salish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. And we thank them also for being on their territory. It's my job today, I think, to talk a little bit more particularly about the CEDAW inquiry process, why we decided to do that, what actually has happened, and what we think about the results that we have. Because I know that there are a lot of people there who care about CEDAW as I do, and what it's able to do for us in this circumstance. So both Don and Sherry have said a little bit about the process, but let me just add a little bit more. You know that because Canada has ratified the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, Canada gets reviewed by the CEDAW committee, that's the Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, regularly, sort of once every, well, it turns out to be 7 or 8 years, I think. So we were reviewed in 2008, and at that time, FAFIA and NWAC also brought forward the issue of murders and disappearances of Aboriginal women and girls and told the committee about it, and encouraged them to make it a priority issue in their report, which they did. That meant that Canada was required to report back to them on what it did on the issue of murders and disappearances within a year. And as Dawn has said, the committee wasn't satisfied with what Canada had done in that period of time, and it accepted some other reports from NGOs, but it was clear that we were going nowhere. So FAFIA and NWAC decided at that point to ask the committee to initiate an inquiry under Article 8 of the Optional Protocol. And in order to initiate that inquiry, the committee has to be able to say to itself that it has reliable information that there's a grave or systematic violation of human rights taking place. And because we'd been through the review process and they already had information from us, and they had information from the Canadian government, quite a lot of it, they clearly, though, they were in a position to be able to say they had they'd met the threshold that they had to meet under the option protocol in order to initiate inquiry. So that was October of 2011. We think what happened, committee encouraged them for a visit. We really wanted them to hear Aboriginal women and girls. We wanted them to hear what people across the country had to say. And we think that the committee then made a request to Canada to come for a visit, and that there was about a year and a half delay before Canada answered, which is why the visit didn't happen until 2013. We've just received the report. It came out in March, early March of this year. And it's an extraordinary report for us. It's groundbreaking in a number of ways. So I just want to spend a little bit of time talking about why it's such an important report that we've gotten. First of all, remember, for those of you who are thinking about CEDAW and the optional protocol and what can happen here, this is only the second inquiry that the CEDAW committee has ever undertaken. So the first inquiry was its inquiry into murders and disappearances of women in Ciudad Juarez in Mexico. And this is the second one. And as Dawn and Sherry have both said, one of the things that sort of, and Alda, one of the things that's sort of extraordinary about this particular report is that the expectation is that Canada is one of the high-ranking countries on women's human rights. And to have a report like this come out about one of the wealthiest nations in the world, one of the ones to have a human rights infrastructure in terms of laws and institutions, is very surprising. And it's groundbreaking. It's new. So that's a really important thing. Remember that we're talking about also very new human rights law, because talking about the obligation of governments to act with due diligence when there's violence against women by third parties, that is by private actors. So this whole report is focused on, which is the focus that we absolutely were seeking, on what are the obligations of Canada, the government of Canada, and all of the provincial and territorial governments and Canadian institutions to protect, prosecute, investigate, prevent, and remedy violence against women that's at the hands of private actors. Now, I say that this part of the law is new, and I'm sure some of the people in the room there know a great deal about this, but really the law on violence against women and the obligations of government has really been in a development since the late 1980s, early 1990s. So we can pat ourselves on the back that we've really made some impact on the rights of women by bringing to the attention and insisting that governments are a part of, governments have a very strong, a central part to play in preventing and remedying violence against women at the private actors. So when the CEDAW committee is looking at this circumstance, they have a couple of jobs in front of them. One is fact-finding, and the other is actually applying the law, the parts of the convention, to the circumstances and deciding whether or not there are violations and what's the nature of the violations that have occurred. Both of those things are extraordinarily important for us because the fact-finding shapes how they understand what the violation. So one of the things that's happened here that I think all of us are extraordinarily pleased about is that the committee has actually stated the history of Canada and the history that Sherry has talked about and that Dawn has talked about the history of colonization, what it actually did to women and girls, what it did to communities, and they've looked at the root causes of the violence. So they actually find as facts that the violence is rooted in Canada's colonial history, including the residential schools policy and the sex discrimination in that act, which is on yet, and in the social and economic marginalization that's caused, the psychological trauma, the social dislocation. So they've stared into this history and said, this violence is rooted in this deeply entrenched sexism and racism, the colonialism, the patriarchy that Sherry was talking about, that got into everything, that got into the lives, that affected the lives, that shaped the lives of women and girls and men and boys in all parts of the Aboriginal community. And as Sherry said so rightly, I think, shaped non-Aboriginal people too by encouraging, fostering racist and sexist attitudes on the part of non-Aboriginal people. They've also found that the police and the justice system in Canada has failed profoundly to respond adequately to the violence that's occurred. Failed to respond in the ways that Sherry and Don have described, by being dismissive, by not answering, by being discriminatory, by failing to investigate, in some cases failing to prosecute, failing to take reports of missing women. So the policing in Canada has failed, and so has the justice system in responding adequately. Partly what gets talked about, which I think is extraordinarily important, is huge failures in coordination. The story of Maisie Ojik and her friend Shana Alexander is a really excellent one, as Don has said, because the police fought over jurisdiction. There were different police forces. They couldn't get together. They couldn't decide whose responsibility it was. The same thing happened in Vancouver surrounding area about the women who were murdered by Robert William Picton. So the Coquitlam police and Vancouver police, some of the RCMP detachments, they all had concerns and conflicts about whose job it really was. And no ways of, apparently, of resolving these, no protocols, etc. So the committee has also huge failures in the policing. There are three sort of aspects of what the CEDAW committee has done that I'd like to highlight, because I think for Aboriginal women and girls in Canada and for all women and girls in Canada, they're very, very important. And the first one is this, that the committee's report has managed to pull together civil and political rights and economic and social rights, and to make them, as the UN system always says to us, indivisible. In women's real experience, those rights are indivisible. We don't have life or security of the person or liberty unless we have an adequate standard of living, water, housing, adequate food, access to education. So in women's real lives, those rights have to be understood to be indivisible. This report has actually pulled those things together, and I mean that in this sense. It's dealt with the failures of the police and the justice system. it's also dealt with those root causes and the social and economic marginalization of the women, the profound social and economic disadvantage that makes the women and girls so vulnerable. Now, the reason why that's so important and why NWAC and FAFIA have insisted on this in all of the international human rights work that we've done is because it's too easy. And it's the place that everybody wants to immediately go to say this is simply a police problem. And we'll solve it by making the police response better. Now, I don't want to be understood to say that the police response isn't really important. It is really important. It is crucial that police respond, provide equal protection of the law, that the justice system works, that we have access to it adequately, that Aboriginal women and girls are respected and treated without discrimination. But remember that the police response comes after the fact, after the violence. And so do, I have to say, the shelters and the victim services and etc. What we also have to be focused on is preventing the violence from occurring and remedying it in such a way that it doesn't occur again. So the prevent and remedy part of this is extraordinarily important, and it's the reason why we've had such a strong focus on the root causes, the social and economic marginalization of Aboriginal women and girls, which makes them so vulnerable and so constrained in their abilities to get away from violence, to escape from it. So this report, in its recommendations and in its whole sort of approach to its understanding of what it's looking at, has integrated those aspects of the issue very strongly and very importantly. And so it's seeing violence against Aboriginal women and girls not just as a matter of criminal law and police response, but also as a matter of the root causes, the social and economic marginalization that is the vulnerability and the risk that the Aboriginal women and girls have to begin with. So that's one thing I think is really important. The second thing I think is really important in this is that this report, as the Inter-American Commission's report, has dealt with Aboriginal women and girls as a group. And again, this is for us as women a really important thing, because one of the things that tends to happen is that we look at these things and we want to turn them into individual problems. We want to say, oh, it's because, as Dawn has said, oh, she lives a risky lifestyle. She went partying, right? It was her fault. We want to blame it, and we want to individualize it and not look at the big picture and take into account the forces that are operating to make this into a big picture, a big issue, a crisis of violence against Aboriginal women and girls. A lot of people who are in that room, I think, will remember that our Prime Minister has had a real, really clear approach in his own mind about this. He says this is a matter of crime and the police should deal with it. He thinks of it as individual crimes, and he has said publicly, it's not a sociological phenomenon. One of the things that's clear from this report and from the Inter-American Commission's report is that they understand very clearly that what they're looking at is a sociological phenomenon. It's something that's happening to a group. As Dawn said, if you're born Indigenous in Canada, you're born at risk. So that's also really important. The third thing that I think is really important here is that the violations of the convention that the committee has identified are failures. So it's very important to us in terms of understanding what rights mean to understand that the government violates our rights when it fails to act. Not just when it acts overtly in a discriminatory way, but when it fails to act to actually positively create equality for Indigenous women and girls. And in this particular report, the CEDAW committee has said, Canada has failed. And that's where the violations of the rights are. So it says, and here are the failures. The protracted failure of Canada to take effective measures to protect Aboriginal women and girls, although it's clear that a coordinated response is required. The failure of our established legislative and institutional legal framework to provide effective protections and remedies. So even though we have laws that should protect Indigenous women and girls, institutions, courts, they have not. So they failed. The failure to take adequate steps to address the stereotyping of Aboriginal women and girls, including stereotyping them as prostitutes, transient, runaways, living high-risk lifestyles, and an indifferent attitude towards the reports of missing Aboriginal women. The failure to take into account the increased vulnerability of Aboriginal women and girls because of discrimination based on both sex and race. The failure to take into account the particular problems of Aboriginal women living in remote communities. The failure to provide sufficient coordination between different jurisdictions and the institutions of the state. And finally, the failure to ensure the realization of economic, social, political, and cultural rights of Aboriginal women, which includes education, housing, transportation, support to families and children, and an adequate standard of living, both on and off reserves. So, That's a very serious, complicated, both finding of fact and ruling that the committee has made here. And it's given Canada 38 recommendations, saying that it wants all of them implemented, not on a piecemeal basis, thank you. And one of those, of course, is that there be a national inquiry. So the CEDAW committee, like the Inter-American Commission, like James Anaya, doesn't see that their interventions are necessarily the whole solution. They believe that there should be a national inquiry so that, in fact, governments and Aboriginal women and girls and Aboriginal communities can actually get everything out in the open and design the strategies that are actually going to work to make the difference here. The recommendations are extensive. We think that they're all in the right, all going in the right direction. They have to do with police, police oversight, police protocols, police standards of training, standards of conduct, coordination among police systems, coordinations among institutions of in the justice system, and then also about services and supports to women and about real strategies to address social and economic marginalization, including a national anti-poverty strategy, housing, and so on. So as I say, they're very extensive. So part of what we are up against here is that Canada's response to this report and to the Inter-American Commission's report is, first of all, to say there are no grave violations of human rights happening here. So although the CEDAW committee has very clearly gone through all of this, done an extensive fact-finding, made a ruling on which articles of the convention have been violated, and says this amounts to a grave violation because of the serious consequences of the violations for Aboriginal women and girls, that is loss of life. This is a grave violation. Canada says there are no grave violations. It also says, well, of your 38 recommendations, we're already partially carrying out 34 of them. The other ones we're not going to do. That's a national inquiry and a national action plan. And that's Canada's response. No one that I've heard of thinks, except the government of Canada, thinks that that's an adequate response. So here we are. I would say, I'd be interested to hear what Sherry and Dawn say. I think we've moved a long way forward on the issue of murders and disappearances of Aboriginal women and girls from 2005, 2008, when we went to the CEDAW committee at the time of the last review. And I say that because I think that the issue is much more widely understood, there's a wide support for a national inquiry. I think the understanding of the issue is much more sophisticated than it was. I think the Truth and Reconciliation Commission has added to that because they see the murders and disappearances of Aboriginal women and girls connected to the history of residential schools as the Inter-American Commission has and as the CEDAW Committee has. I think it's important that we're at a point where the murders and disappearances are now, I think, understood as part of what the Truth and Reconciliation Commission has called cultural genocide. And so this is part of a very big pattern that everybody has to stare into. And I agree with Dawn completely. This is not just an Aboriginal women's issue. This is an issue for all of us. It's an issue for all Canadians. It's an issue for Canada. It's extraordinarily important that we can have this kind of examination that we've gotten from the CEDAW committee, and that we all can look at what's happening here and understand it in terms of human rights and the violations of human rights that are happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. That was very clear. Thank you. I think that it's not only important for Canadians, I think it's important for everyone around the world. And I invite all of you to read the report. You can find it on the website of the CEDAW committee. And in fact, there have been three inquiry procedures done by the CEDAW committee, one on CEDAW Juarez, which was also on murdered and disappeared women, and one on the Philippines on reproductive rights and the ban on the sale of contraceptives in the Philippines, and this one on the murdered and disappeared women in Aboriginal women in Canada. So the importance for as Sheila said, not only that we should all support the end of this violence, is that the way it describes the violations and the failures can help everyone here. Everyone from all these different countries that we have can help to understand what it means when a country has failed women. So read it and use it. Use the report to lobby for your rights in wherever country you're from or here in Canada also. Thank you all for this important part of the panel, which was on the inquiry of the murdered and disappeared. It's true that it should be not missing, it should be disappeared. This is what, it's human right language is disappeared. I was just being respectful and saying what you have said, but it is about, the human right violation is disappeared. And there's a convention on the disappearance of people. And the second part of the panel, we're going to hear from Silvia Tecun León from Guatemala, Amaya Quiche. She's going to share with you, I don't know all the things that she's going to share with you, but she's going to share with you about this initiative that they started in her organization, Sununiha, for a general recommendation from the CEDAW committee on the rights, individual and collective rights of Indigenous women. This is a different kind of procedure. The CEDAW committee has the attribute to make these general recommendations based on Article 21 of the CEDAW Convention. And there are now 32 general recommendations on different issues and on different groups of women. And for the first time, what is happening is that the petition is coming from the women themselves. All of the general recommendations that exist until now have been initiated by the CEDAW committee itself. This would be the first time that is a petition from the women all over the world to have this general recommendation. And so it's also a very exciting process because you can get involved, you can support. There will be a day of general discussion on this recommendation if they accept to do it, and then you can give all your feedback to the committee on this. So with this, I will leave Silvia to talk. She will be speaking in Spanish, but you can say hello in your language before
so we can hear it. En pitnas parmit ishimuleu en koural richken ichchive tsukchak gnom khala chak gnom rich rungel och ishqib och maya en maltioschive en good afternoon. I speak with in my language, in my mother language, it's Quiche. I am from Guatemala, I am a lawyer, I can speak very well English, and thank you for Lorena, she is helped me for traduction my speech, and it's interesting, I listened all the experience of the woman here in Canada, it's the same in Guatemala. The history is same, yeah, with all the indigenous women, and I would like we work hard, and I would like all our human rights for indigenous women can be. Yeah, sorry. I would like to explain for us our name is Tununija. It's my language, Quiche, and I would like to share the meaning for our name. The meaning of Tunun, it's the hummingbird, sorry, thank you. It's hummingbird, and Ija, it's seal, and Ja, it's water. Tununija, the mean is the hummingbird that carries the seal water. The seed which is able to then germinate, yeah? And Ununija, it's one of the fields of the four grandmothers according to the Popol Vuh. The Popol Vuh is our sacred book of Mayan people in Guatemala. Yeah, and the Popol Vuh is from Chichicastenango, and I am from Chichicastenango in Guatemala. Okay, I am beginning with my presentation, and thank you, Lorena, for helping me. I speak in Spanish. Hablar de la violencia contra las mujeres indígenas requiere hacer un análisis retrospectivo sobre su historia, ya que la violencia contra las mujeres se manifiesta en diversas formas, tales como la violencia física, sexual, psicológica y económica. Desencadenando de un sistema patriarcal, es necesario reconocer que para nosotras los procesos de invasión, colonización y guerras internas se aplicó la violencia con una brutalidad distinta que se estructuró en relación al sexo y a la condición étnica. Sin duda alguna, estos procesos significaron la ruptura de la organización sociopolítica y la imposición de un modelo económico, político, cultural que afectó directamente a las mujeres indígenas, ya que se impuso en un sistema de dominación basado en la violencia. Un ejemplo claro es la ruptura que se encuentra en una de las crónicas de Diego de Landa, analizado por la maestra maya Victoria Tubín, en la cual expresa: es gran deshonestidad que las mujeres anden desnudas, como andan entre los naturales. Mando a que ninguna india fuese a lavar con los hombres donde ellos se bañan, ni anden en hábitos de hombre, ni el varón en el de mujer, aunque fuese por causa de regocijo. Analizando este párrafo, pues podemos ver cómo el pudor y el morbo hacia la mujer se instala desde la colonia, al prohibir la libertad de los cuerpos. Asimismo, la segregación estricta de los espacios sociales de acuerdo al rol del hombre y de la mujer.
Speak about violence against Indigenous women requires us to take a historical view. Violence against women in a patriarchal system manifests itself in a variety of ways: physical, sexual, psychological, and economic. For us, Indigenous women, we need to also look at historical processes like occupation, colonization, and internal wars, where violence becomes articulated with gender and ethnicity. The application of these particular modes of violence against Indigenous populations led to the destruction of existing socio-political modes of social organization among these communities. The imposed economic, political, and cultural model directly affected Indigenous women because it was based on violence. As an example, I'm pointing to the work of Mayan scholar Dr. Victoria Tubin, who points to a clear example of this process in her work on the Chronicles of Diego de Landa in the following quote. And this is the quote: "It is a great dishonesty on the part of these women whose habit is to walk about in a natural state. It is ordered that no Indian woman should bathe herself in areas where men are present, nor should women dress in men's attire, or men dress as women, even if it's done in jest or as part of some festivity," end quote. In this quote, we see an example of how the bodies of Indigenous women are inserted in colonial ideas of shame and sexual mores so that they no longer have freedom with regard to their bodies. They are forced into a colonial gender ideology that relies on the strict segregation of women and men's roles.
Sin duda alguna, la colonización violentó las condiciones de vida de los pueblos indígenas y seguidamente de las mujeres, quienes perdieron todo el orden social, político, económico, de la cual formaban parte, convirtiéndose en objeto de marginación y subordinación mediante una violencia justificada por el racismo y el patriarcado. En este sentido, es importante mencionar que los mecanismos utilizados para la subordinación de los pueblos y de mujeres indígenas fueron la iglesia, la educación y la militarización. La iglesia, mediante la imposición de un ser mujer blanca, casta, pura, donde la mujer soltera debía guardarle honor a la familia y la casada al esposo. Esta concepción es motivo de reproducción del pensamiento y de acciones que generan la violencia hoy en día. La educación, un aparato reproductor de la ideología dominante del Estado. En esta se despojó a las mujeres de su identidad y se asumió una explicación científica sobre la inferioridad de esta, por medio del racismo y el patriarcado. Y la militarización fue utilizada para mantener el control territorial, control de pensamiento, control del cuerpo y de la libertad de la mujer.
The process of colonization violently ruptured traditional ways of life among indigenous populations. For indigenous women, this meant losing the ways in which their lives had been socially, politically, and economically organized, and being thrust into a colonial order that marginalized and subordinated them through violence. A violence that was justified through both patriarchy and racism. Some of the mechanisms of domination used to subordinate indigenous peoples and indigenous women included religion, education, and militarization. In terms of religion, the church imposed an ideal of womanhood as white, chaste, and pure, where a woman's role was, if single, to preserve her family's honor, or if married, her husband's honor. These colonial gender ideologies continue to be reproduced today in terms of both attitudes and behaviors, thus having a direct impact on violence against women. Education as a system for the reproduction of dominant state ideologies was used to strip indigenous women of their identity and to propagate ideas of indigenous women's inferiority through the use of patriarchal and racialized so-called scientific knowledge. Processes of militarization were used to gain control over indigenous people's lands and to attempt the domination of indigenous people's bodies, minds, and freedoms.
Es necesario contextualizar que el racismo es un mecanismo de opresión utilizado por la clase dominante, en donde los pueblos indígenas fueron sometidos a una invasión e imposición de una cultura extraña, utilizando una transculturalización violenta, un cuasi-etnocidio, como afirma Marta Elena Casaus en su libro La metamorfosis del racismo, que indica, el racismo no es un fenómeno estático, sino que se renueva y se transforma constantemente, es decir, la metamorfosis del racismo y de su capacidad de mutación camaleónica. Sufre variaciones en su forma, pero no en su esencia, porque sus efectos y nivel de violencia no cambian. Hablando siempre del racismo, Michel Foucault dice, en la modernidad es más compleja. No es fácil identificar el racismo, su manera de enunciarse no es el mismo, porque depende de los contextos históricos, económicos, políticos e ideológicos, y muy ligada a los modelos de producción económica.
Racism is a mechanism of oppression used by those in power. This system was historically used on indigenous peoples to conquer their lands and to impose a foreign or external culture on them. This process of violent transculturation can be characterized as a kind of ethnocide. As Marta Casaus tells us in her book, The Metamorphosis of Racism, racism, quote, is not a static phenomenon, but rather it is constantly renewing and transforming itself. That is to say, racism's metamorphosis and its chameleon-like capacity for mutation may be expressed in a variety of modes, but its essence remains because its effects and levels of violence don't change, end quote. As Michel Foucault says, in modernity, identifying or recognizing racism may be more complex because the way in which it manifests itself depends on historical, economic, political, and ideological contexts that are linked to modes of economic production.
De acuerdo a lo expuesto anteriormente, afirmamos que la violencia contra las mujeres indígenas es sistemática y que aún continúa, ya que en estos tiempos las mujeres indígenas enfrentamos violencias desde el ámbito privado y del ámbito público. En el ámbito privado, la violencia más común que enfrentamos se desarrolla en el núcleo familiar, en su mayoría con el esposo o conviviente, quien ejerce mayormente la violencia hacia las mujeres. Sin embargo, la violencia contra nosotras no solo se ejerce en el seno del hogar, sino también en el ámbito público, expresándose en todos los espacios, tanto laborales, educativos y más de tipo social, menospreciándola en todo sentido. Me gustaría mencionar que dentro del ámbito público, que mujeres indígenas enfrentamos una violencia severa, deshumana y continua, esta violencia es institucionalizada, la violencia del Estado, la violencia política. Al igual que en la colonia y guerras internas evidencian una serie de violaciones a los derechos individuales y colectivos de las mujeres indígenas. En la actualidad, el sistema económico neoliberal, racista, impone el modelo de extracción poniendo en riesgo la vida de las mujeres y especialmente de las mujeres indígenas.
Given what's been said, violence against indigenous women can be categorized as systemic and continuing as a present-day phenomenon that is experienced by indigenous women in both the private and public spheres. In the private sphere, the more common modes of violence we face as women are found within the nuclear family, where it is typically the husband or male partner who is, for the most part, responsible for the violence experienced by women. But the violence against us as indigenous women is not only experienced in the home, but also in the spaces where we work, in spaces of education, as well as other social sites where we are undervalued. As indigenous women in the public sphere, we face severe, dehumanizing, and continuous forms of violence, institutional violence, violence of the state, and political violence. Akin to colonial times and to times of war, a series of violations to both our individual and collective rights as indigenous women continue to occur. Presently, women's lives are put at risk within the racist and neoliberal economic system that represent the ideological foundation for the model of extraction in place that is being used to exploit natural resources.
Las instalaciones de megaproyectos, hidroeléctricas, cementeras, etc., han causado un impacto negativo en la vida social, política y cultural económica de las mujeres indígenas. Y ante el rechazo de estos megaproyectos que afectan el entorno social de todos los habitantes. Los gobiernos centrales utilizan mecanismos legitimados por el sistema jurídico de los distintos países, tales como el estado de sitio, órdenes de capturas a líderes y lideresas. Un ejemplo claro es el caso de 8 mujeres de la aldea de San Miguel Ixtahuacán, San Marcos, Guatemala, a quienes se les giró órdenes de captura por mantener su lucha en los efectos de la mina implantada en su comunidad. Algunos de estos efectos de la mina fueron las casas dañadas, la pérdida de nacimientos de agua, las enfermedades en la piel de las mujeres, de sus hijas e hijos, casos de violencia por parte de los trabajadores de la empresa. La violencia sexual se hace presente y se declara en un estado de sitio, por ejemplo, el acoso sexual a las mujeres mayas cachiqueles, que sufrieron en el estado de sitio promulgado por el Estado de Guatemala en el año 2008. Los intentos de violencia hacia las mujeres por efectos del Ejército de Guatemala, así como durante el estado de prevención promulgado también por el Estado de Guatemala en el año 2014 en San Juan, Zacatepeques. Los desalojos violentos en el área del Polochic, los estados de sitio en Alta Verapaz, Petén, han dejado secuelas profundas para la vida y el entorno social de las mujeres indígenas. Estos casos, aunque corresponden a Guatemala, son un ejemplo claro de lo que enfrentan las mujeres indígenas del mundo.
For indigenous women, the building of large mega mining and hydroelectric projects, as well as of large cement factories, have had serious and negative effects on their social, political, cultural, and economic lives. When the building of mega projects faces opposition from indigenous communities, communities who are directly and adversely impacted by these large projects, as they usually live in the regions where these projects are being built, the government is able to use legal mechanisms such as declaring a state of siege or a state of emergency, or issuing orders of arrest against those leaders who oppose the projects. A clear example of this is the case of 8 women from the small village of San Miguel Ixtahuacán, San Marcos, Guatemala, where orders of arrest were issued against these women because they opposed the mine built in their community. The reasons for opposing the mine included the damage done to their houses, the loss of sources of water in the community, the skin diseases that affected adults and children, as well as the rapes of women by employees of the mining company. When states of emergency are declared, sexual violence usually occurs. We have the examples of the sexual harassment suffered by Maya Cachiqueles women during the 2008 state of emergency declared by the Guatemalan state. Also examples in the attempted rapes of women by members of the Guatemalan army during the government's declared state of prevention in 2014 in San Juan, Zacatepeques. In the violent evictions that occurred in Polochic and in the state of emergency declared in Alta Verapaz y Petén, all of which produce severe impacts and consequences on indigenous women's lives and their social worlds. These examples, although they refer specifically to Guatemala, can be said to have common elements to some of the effects and consequences experienced by indigenous women all over the world.
Los efectos del sistema económico afectan de forma directa a las mujeres indígenas, porque gracias a la mayoría de nosotras se ha preservado la cultura, las prácticas económicas y la cosmovisión que han protegido los recursos naturales. Ya que nuestros territorios constituyen algunos de los lugares inexplorados que aún quedan en la tierra. En la actualidad, al igual que en la historia de la construcción del Estado, la violencia contra las mujeres indígenas opera mediante distintas relaciones de poder que genera el sistema racista, machista y económico denominado por algunos académicos el colonialismo. En la CEPAL, en su panorama social de América Latina del año 2006, estimaba que la población indígena de América Latina superaba los 40 millones de personas y que dicho sector se encuentra afectado por la constante discriminación estructural y expresa su marginidad en exclusión y pobreza.
The economic system directly impacts indigenous women because it is thanks to indigenous women that our culture, our alternative economic practices, and our indigenous cosmovisions have been maintained. These practices have typically included the protection of natural resources because our territories, our lands, are made up of some of the Earth's remaining unexplored regions. At present, in a similar fashion to the time when nations were first being built, violence against indigenous women operates through diverse power relations that are arrived at via the intersection of systems of racism, sexism, and economic, that some academics refer to as colonialism. In its 2006 Social Panorama of Latin America report by the United Nations Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, ECLAC, it estimated that the indigenous population of Latin America represented over 40 million people, which continue to be affected by forms of structural discrimination that include social marginalization, exclusion, and poverty.
En conclusión, las mujeres indígenas a lo largo de la historia venimos arrastrando formas de dominación sobre nuestro ser, sobre nuestro cuerpo y el rol dentro de la sociedad desde la imposición de la violencia colonial. Hemos pasado a ser objetos sexuales utilizadas por los trabajos forzosos, perdiendo nuestra autonomía para convertirnos en objeto de propiedad para los hombres. Consecuencia de ello es que las mujeres indígenas no contamos con acceso a la justicia, salud, educación, servicios públicos y mucho menos a espacios de toma de decisión.
Throughout our history, indigenous women have been carrying the burden of domination that has been forced on our beings, our bodies, and on the kinds of roles we can play in society. Colonial violence has tried to convert us into sexual objects and place us into systems of forced labor that deny us our autonomy as well as making us men's private property. As a consequence, as indigenous women, we have little access to justice, health, education, public services, and even less access to spaces where decision making takes place.
Por lo que la lucha para que se reconozcan, se respeten los derechos individuales y colectivos de las mujeres indígenas es de suma importancia para la dignificación de nuestras vidas. Es importante mencionar que el sistema de Naciones Unidas ha jugado un rol preponderante con la emisión de convenciones internacionales a favor de los derechos y la no discriminación en contra de las mujeres en diferentes ámbitos. Y en especial, se hace un análisis de las mujeres indígenas sobre los alcances que ha tenido específicamente la Convención sobre la Eliminación de Todas las Formas de Discriminación en contra de la mujer, la CEDAW. Pero es necesario enfatizar que la mayoría de convenios internacionales excluyen en sus cláusulas como la condición de subordinación de las mujeres indígenas. No solo es el resultado de la discriminación por razón de género, sino también por la persistencia de un pensamiento racista que se niega a reconocer los derechos individuales y colectivos. Es de reconocer que la Convención CEDAW busca erradicar todas las formas de discriminación en contra de la mujer a nivel mundial. Sin embargo, en todos los países del mundo existen millones de personas indígenas y que de ellas, de la mitad, son mujeres indígenas.
The struggle for the recognition and respect of the individual and collective rights of Indigenous women is of extreme importance. It is a struggle to regain the honor and respect, the dignity that was taken away from our lives. The United Nations has played an important role with the International Conventions in Defense of Human Rights and Women's Rights. We turn specifically to the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, and examine how Indigenous women's rights have been included. We point out that the majority of UN international conventions do not include stipulations or articles that deal specifically with the particular forms of discrimination faced by Indigenous women who have been not only subjugated because of their gender, but also because of racism, which denies Indigenous peoples their collective and individual rights. CEDAW's objective is to help in the elimination of all forms of discrimination against women worldwide, but we need to recognize that in the world's nations, we find Indigenous populations numbering in the millions, and that Indigenous women make up more than half of these populations.
Consideramos que el comité CEDAW daría un paso significativo si toma en cuenta el racismo. Es consustancial a la opresión de género y es un problema estructural a nivel mundial. Han condenado a millones de mujeres indígenas a vivir en condiciones infrahumanas, donde los estados partes deben de transformar los sistemas políticos, económicos y sociales que históricamente y que de manera sistemática han discriminado, subordinado, excluido y hasta querer eliminar y borrar la memoria histórica en la niñez, en las mujeres, hombres, indígenas.
We therefore consider that the CEDAW Committee would take a significant step if it were to take into account how gender oppression and racism intersect to create systemic and structural problems that have condemned Indigenous women to live in subhuman conditions worldwide. Participating states should be urged to recognize and take steps to change the political, economic, legal, and social systems that have historically and systemically discriminated, excluded, and subordinated Indigenous women and men, to the point of even wanting to erase our people's childhoods and our historical memory.
Por todas estas circunstancias, el movimiento de mujeres indígenas Tununija, en el año 2009 hace un informe alternativo donde consideró las recomendaciones en los numerales 34 y 35 del Comité de la CEDAW, que hizo al Estado en su sexto y séptimo informe periódico presentados en los años 2003 y el 2007. Se hizo un proceso de elaboración de informe y se tomó como prioridad lo relevante para informar y demandar la situación de condición de las mujeres indígenas, donde se llevaron a cabo encuentros regionales en los distintos puntos del país para analizar, consultar, redactar y validar un informe. De las principales recomendaciones solicitadas fueron el acceso a la justicia, la violencia, política para la eliminación de la discriminación, la participación política, política laboral, salud, economía y la situación de la mujer rural. Un proceso de socialización, de jornadas, debates y análisis sobre el contenido de la CEDAW y como resultado contamos con un documento denominado Análisis y elementos para una propuesta de recomendación general para garantizar los derechos de las mujeres indígenas a considerarse por el Comité para la Eliminación de la discriminación racial en contra de las mujeres. Documento que contiene la visión de las mujeres indígenas. Con este documento se inicia un proceso de cabildeo, de socialización y de divulgación con organizaciones para hacer alianzas con intereses comunes. Acercamiento con las mujeres en América Latina, un encuentro de mujeres indígenas en Mesoamérica sobre los derechos humanos y la CEDAW, con el objeto de mejorar el documento con diferentes insumos y distintas visiones del mundo.
Due to the factors discussed already, in 2009, the Movimiento de Mujeres Indígenas Tsununija, Indigenous Women's Movement Tsununija, led the work on the creation of an alternative report for the CEDAW Committee. This report would focus on the CEDAW Committee's recommendations 34 and 35, recommendations that had been presented to the Guatemalan state and government in 2003 and 2007. The aim was to produce a report that would clearly focus on the specific situation and conditions faced by Indigenous women. Throughout the country, regional meetings were held to analyze the CEDAW Convention and to collectively discuss, create, and approve this alternative report. Some of the principal points covered in this report include recommendations dealing with violence, access to justice, the development of policies that deal with discrimination, political participation, labor issues, health, and the economy, and the specific situation of women in rural areas. The document that came out of this initial process and that contained Indigenous women's perspectives was entitled Facts and Analysis for the Development of a General Proposal to the CEDAW Committee to Guarantee Indigenous Women's Rights. With this document, a process of consultation, discussion, and dissemination started, whose objectives were to form alliances with individuals and organizations with shared perspectives and goals, to develop closer ties with women's organizations throughout the Latin American region, to have a transnational meeting of Indigenous women from Central America and Mexico, to discuss human rights issues and CEDAW in order to come up with recommendations to improve the document.
En la actualidad, se cuenta con un documento que es el resultado de los aportes de las lideresas y organizaciones de mujeres indígenas de distintos países, con el objeto de plantearle al Comité de la CEDAW que emita una recomendación general para mujeres indígenas, tomando en cuenta sus derechos individuales y colectivos. Para este proceso han participado organizaciones indígenas de México, Honduras, Costa Rica, Panamá, Colombia, Nepal y Canadá, también Guatemala, y el mismo ha sido impulsado y liderado desde Guatemala por las siguientes organizaciones: Movimiento de Mujeres Indígenas Tsununija, Tiktik Naoj, Asociación Maya Ukushbe, Sinergia Noj, Equipo de Estudios Comunitarios y Acción Psicológica ECAP y Asociadas por lo Justo JAS.
Out of this effort, a document was developed as a joint national, and another document was developed as a joint national and international effort led by Guatemalan indigenous women's organizations like the Movimiento de Mujeres Indígenas Tsununija, Tiknaoj, Asociación Maya Ukshbe, Sinergia Noj, Equipos de Estudio Comunitarios y Acción Psicosocial ECAP, and JAS Associates, and JAS, as well as by participating groups from Colombia, Panama, Canada, Nepal, and Mexico. The goal of the document is to argue before the CEDAW Committee in July of this year to issue a specific general recommendation on Indigenous women based on the proposals contained in the document that addressed the specific demands for the collective individual rights of Indigenous women.
Con este proceso que hemos venido haciendo, le solicitaremos al Comité CEDAW recomendar a los estados parte que asuman su obligación de promover transformaciones de fondo y que es necesario que promuevan con urgencia acciones para la institucionalización de políticas sociales, culturales, económicas, de apoyo a la participación política de mujeres indígenas basada en la perspectiva étnico, cultural y de género, como mecanismo necesario para erradicar la barrera de carácter estructural que han postergado el desarrollo social, cultural, económico y científico de las mujeres indígenas. Asimismo, se les solicitará que recomiende la implementación de medidas para erradicar los estereotipos y prácticas folclóricas y racistas en las escuelas, hospitales, mercados, centros comerciales, iglesias y otras instituciones. La sociedad en general y el Estado deberá de comprender los estereotipos que se le dan a los pueblos indígenas, reconociendo a los pueblos indígenas como sujetos sociales y políticos de derechos, dejando atrás la visión de naciones y sociedades homogéneas y estados monoculturales, entre otros.
We will be asking with this document the CEDAW Committee to make recommendations to all ratifying states to play a serious role in making the required transformations and taking the urgent actions needed to promote the institutionalization of social, cultural, and economic measures that support the full participation of Indigenous women. These measures should be based on the recognition of Indigenous ethnocultural and gender perspectives as a means to eliminate the structural barriers that have impeded or delayed the social, cultural, economic, and scientific development of Indigenous women. We will also be requesting that recommendations be made to eliminate those practices that rely on racialized stereotypes and the folklorization of Indigenous lives found in everyday spaces like schools, hospitals, markets, shopping centers, and other state institutions. The objective is to recognize Indigenous peoples as socio-political subjects whose specific demands need to be addressed, and in so doing, leaving behind notions of nations and societies as homogeneous and unicultural.
Y como parte de esta iniciativa, pues estamos aquí presentando el documento y solicitando el apoyo para que nos sumemos al esfuerzo y poder respaldar esta iniciativa en lucha y acompañamiento a las mujeres indígenas de todo el mundo. Y queremos pedir a todas las mujeres indígenas, no indígenas, mujeres aliadas, que puedan sumarse a este reto. Este es un esfuerzo, y lo vemos como un esfuerzo para iniciar a abrir brechas específicamente para mujeres indígenas, y será un gran acontecimiento que el Comité de la CEDAW pueda emitir una recomendación general específicamente de mujeres indígenas, que quedará en la historia y en la memoria de nuestras hijas. Queremos solicitarles que nos apoyen firmando y compartiendo, divulgando este esfuerzo, que es un esfuerzo de todas. Y asimismo, quiero agradecer especialmente a Ángela y a Alda y al Instituto Women's Human Rights Institute, que hace lo posible esta actividad para poder compartir estas alianzas y poder hacer más alianzas con otras mujeres del mundo.
As part of this effort, a transnational collaboration, we are providing you with copies of the document, asking for your support. We ask all who are here, as Indigenous people or as allies, to add your support to the struggle of Indigenous women worldwide. We ask you to add your name and voice to this great challenge so that we can begin to create better opportunities for Indigenous women all over the world. It would be a significant feat in the struggle and a historic gain for our daughters if the CEDAW Committee were able to issue a general recommendation that specifically deals with a particular situation and conditions faced by Indigenous women. You can support this collaborative effort by signing, sharing, and disseminating the document throughout your networks. I would also like to thank the Women's Human Rights Education Institute, Alda and Angela, for making possible this event, as well as all the joint collaborations that have come out because of these activities with other women and their organizations. Thank you very much.
Maltiosh, Maltiosh Chiwe, gracias, thank you.
Great. So there's obviously, we could use another 3 hours for dialogue, but we're probably not able to sit and discuss anymore. So I wanted to thank very much all of our speakers, Alda, Dawn, Cherry, Sylvia, and Sylvia's translation team support. And briefly, there are a lot of volunteers and staff that were involved in supporting the event. So can you all just stand up really quickly? It takes a lot to put on an event like this. Just stand up. There's some other volunteers outside. I have a list of about 10 people, but just suffice it to say that to put on an educational program like we do, and even to have an event like this just to try to spread the word, takes a lot of resources. And so I really want to thank everybody who's been integrally involved, especially Juliana Coughlin, who I think needs to stand up, because she organized about 99% of what happened today. Thank you, Juliana. I also just wanted to acknowledge and thank our videographers here. We have Laksha Tungana, who is the also the coordinator of the Center for Women's Studies and Education, and Suraj Sharma. And in the audience, we also have Professor Angela Miles, who is the co-founder of the Women's Human Rights Education Institute and has supported the activities of the center, and so is very integrally committed to making these spaces happen as well. I see we have Sheila back, so can I thank Sheila now? Thank you very much for being with us. And again, there's a lot of information in the materials that we've given you, so if we can support you at all in following up. And we really need help in disseminating that online petition. With the avas, the numbers, as they creep up, become really powerful. So please do visit the link, share it on your social media, and disseminate it wherever you can. Thank you very much.